Mike, thank you. Thank you so much. Welcome, everyone. I hope everyone's having a great day. Ruth Porat, I'm so happy to speak to you because AI could change everything for the good, maybe for the worse at certain parts, but where do you think we are in 2025 in terms of advancing technologies in AI, but also adoption?
First, great to be here. This is always a wonderful event, so delighted to be here. Look, I think where we are with AI is it is both moving really fast and really slow. And what I mean by that is when you focus on the science, the breakthroughs in science are breathtaking, the pace at which we're seeing advancement. And I think one of the best ways to think about that is actually with my colleague, Demis Hassabis, who runs Google DeepMind, and the work he did to develop something called AlphaFold, which is the 3D prediction of protein structures, which is viewed as the single greatest contribution to drug discovery in our lifetime. And he went from working on that, he's been in neuroscience and computer science physics for his whole life, but 4 years ago started on this journey to take on what had been a 50-year grand challenge to predict protein structure of the protein structures for all known proteins. And in 4 years, he went from an idea that people challenged, is it possible, and he said, why not, to a solution, which has now been open sourced. 3 million scientists around the world are using it, 190 countries, and the Nobel Prize. That is the speed of change, and we're seeing that across Google DeepMind. What is slow is actually the implementation in both the public and the private sector. We're still very early days. The excitement about AI is across the board. The economic upside, $4 trillion potential contribution to GDP by 2030 with proper application across industry and the public sector, what's called diffusion. It's the better delivery of healthcare, better delivery of education. And that is still very early days. AI is clearly a lot more than a chatbot. It's about a fundamental rethink of the processes that we have. And I would say for each one of us as leaders, we need to start on that journey.
So why do you think, Ruth, adoption is so slow or slower compared to the innovation? Is it because it's capital intensive and chief executives or even countries don't really know where to go next?
I think one of the key elements is the prioritization, where do I begin?
Yeah.
And I hear that time and time again. And the mental model I keep coming back to, the framework actually anchors on health for a host of reasons. One, I think it is so relevant to each one of us. I've had cancer twice, and so I look at the application of AI in healthcare, and there's so much reason to be optimistic. But when you then think through what are the solutions, how do I prioritize? Actually, the insights from health are relevant across all industries. So first, is saving lives, it's innovation, it's drug discovery. I've already talked about that with AlphaFold. But very importantly, what Demis said when he was awarded the Nobel Prize is, I want to take on the most intractable problems. And when he was challenged as to whether it was possible, his answer was, why not? And I think that's the way we each need to look at innovation, regardless of industry. The second is obviously in healthcare, early detection is the difference between survival and not in many cases, or a really difficult course of treatment. And what is it? In cancer, Google pioneered the early detection of metastatic cancer, breast cancer, lung cancer, and more. And that is literally the proverbial needle in a haystack, finding that early sign of a problem. That is precisely what we do across many different applications. Cybersecurity is about finding the needle in the haystack. In fact, last year, Google DeepMind found with AI that they could see vulnerabilities, find vulnerabilities in software before they were breached. So again, it is fortifying what you're doing in cybersecurity. It's true for fraud, et cetera. And then finally, it's about operating effectiveness, shortage of doctors and nurses around the globe. What we found with AI is you can free them from about 30% of their work, the administrative, basically, drudgery, so they can do what we want as patients, focus on you as a patient, focus on what they want to be doing. And again, that is true across public and private sector. And I just was with a CEO this week who said, yes, the application of AI customer support, what they're hearing from their employees is, thank you for freeing me from that drudgery, and they can do higher level work, and it unlocks capital that can then go into innovation. So I think prioritization is key. I think for everyone in this room, each one of us, actually getting tactile with AI so that you can see how it's used. I learned how to vibe code. I think if I can vibe code, everyone in the room can vibe code. So it's really understanding and then prioritizing.
How do you use it? Do you use it like on a day-to-day?
I do. Well, first of all, we all do, because at Google, we've been infusing it in search for many, many years now. And so I do. I think one of the most exciting applications I keep going back to is something called Notebook LM. If you haven't tried it, upload whatever report or series of reports, and you can actually, you can turn it into a podcast, first of all, but you can also simply synthesize and do cross comparisons, and it's your corpus, so you control the analysis and where you're going.
Ruth, the more we use AI, of course, the more energy it needs. How do you look at energy demand and infrastructure needs?
I like the way you frame that, because the upside from AI is profound, and we can only access it if we actually have the energy to power it. So it's important to keep those as two sides of the same equation. And clearly in the US and in other places, US, we've underinvested in the grid for quite some time, and so we need to catch up. I think what's important is there are both short-term and long-term solutions that are right in front of us. Probably one of the most important, but it's longer-term, is continuing to make advancements in things like nuclear energy, advanced energy solutions. And this is clearly a priority for the administration. We very much agree with it. We think it's imperative that nuclear energy is a part of the energy mix. At Google, as an example, we were the first corporate purchaser for an SMR offtake from Kairos. We've invested in fusion. But this is critical, and when you look at what China's doing, they've been investing in nuclear for quite some time. They have about 30 gigawatts of nuclear in construction, another 200 gigawatts in development. The United States needs to avail itself of that, and I'm pleased the administration is very focused on how to fast-track it. Near-term, there's some really important solutions, and I think what is important, again, if we execute against these things that are right in front of us, we can increase capacity. Yep. Rapidly. We need it now. This is not a 2030 need, it's a now need. We can do it and enhance affordability across the country, which is clearly imperative, generate jobs and decarbonize the grid. And the two best examples are, number one, when you look across the United States, we have underinvested in transmission lines. The reality is there's about 2,500 gigawatts of capacity in development that is waiting to get on the grid, a staggering number. But we need the transmission lines to get it on the grid. To date, it takes about 7 years in the US to build these transition lines. With fast-tracking permitting and other work with states, you can cut that time in half, and some would say even more than that, which is a meaningful unlock. What's potent about that is that it also creates jobs, a meaningful number of jobs. And importantly, the vast majority of that is clean energy. So by getting it on the grid, you're decarbonizing the grid. The second area that I think is really exciting is actually modernizing the grid. There's another 100 gigawatts in the United States that the Department of Energy has estimated could be unlocked if the grid is modernized, applying what's called grid-enhancing technology, something like conductors online so that you can get more capacity through. And again, that creates jobs. It unlocks assets that are here that are being underutilized because they have not been modernized. So I think that, again, there are a number of different solutions at Google. We're working on a whole host of others to improve energy efficiency in chips and in models, delivery across the board. We can, if resolute, and we take each one of the available assets here and execute against them, we can unlock the energy.
Ruth, is that part of the whole package in this AI race? So Google spent the last, you know, quickly actually caught up with OpenAI in the last 2 years. How are US companies doing compared to China, for example? And is the energy complex part of that race?
So energy unequivocally is important. I think the US is ahead in models and in chips and continues to be. I think what's very important is China, as we saw with DeepSeek, is a very active innovator and working, you know, assiduously on AI and the application of AI. So I think there are three critical elements really for the US and the West. Number one is you need to have the energy infrastructure to deliver the upside. And China is focused there. It's not just nuclear, it's also in solar. They're building out whatever they can to have that long-term infrastructure needed to deliver the upside from AI. We have tremendous resources in this country. If we avail ourselves of all of them, we can we can win in this regard. The second is the application. So the upside only comes with each one of us actually unlocking the upside from this, as I've already talked about. Anecdotally, we're hearing China is actually very focused on the application of AI across industry. It's imperative we each do that. It puts us in a better, each company, each country in a better competitive position. And then I think very importantly, it is about embracing working closely with our allies. And so one of the things I'm very proud of is the work we're doing around the globe. Every head of state with whom I meet says, we want to be a part of the digital transformation. We see not just the economic upside, but we can address healthcare requirements. My oncologist, I loved a line he said to me. He said, the only way to democratize healthcare is with AI, because then you actually have a partner to anyone around the world who can deliver this. We're doing amazing work, I think, for example, in Africa on maternal care. There are so many areas where it is available to us now. So they're saying we must be a part of this. That requires, as we look at it at Google, engaging to unlock products and services, which means investing in technical infrastructure, and very importantly, skilling people so that they have the capabilities to actually evolve as the jobs evolve. I view that as a critical triangle, the services, the infrastructure, and the training. And I'm intrigued wherever I go how often I'm asked for, first, help me with the training. We just actually announced, which will be talked about here this week, a very, I think, exciting effort across Africa where we're building out subsea cables to ensure connectivity, resilience, and security across the continent, and really with four hubs, as well as incremental AI digital skilling. And this is really important because a third of the globe still isn't connected. And if you're not connected, you're not going to get the upside from what this offers.
Ruth, we're almost out of time, but actually an important question on responsible AI deployment. What does that look like to you? What are some of the questions that the leaders here need to ask, also in parts of the world, but maybe the framework is not as mature as in other countries?
It's super important. You know, we've talked about it for quite some time. With any technology as potent as this, tremendous upside, and we've talked about it, you've got to protect and mitigate against the downside. And part of that is about this labor transition question, which is why at Google we spend a lot of time on AI skilling and look forward to working with others, or that we did an electrical training program so that there are actually trades jobs that are available. But managing the transition well is really key. Ensuring quality of information is always key, and ensuring access. I think what we're excited about is that, unlike the digital divide, we shouldn't have an AI divide. So much of the service is actually available on a phone. And so this is a way to address what historically has created the divide. And we're, again, another reason to be very excited about it.
Ruth Porat, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. It's great being with you.
Thank you all.